you have a little bit of a background in this, so I feel like I'm sure what you think has some weight.
Okay, we are in the meeting. We do seem to have the correct title, but not the correct description.
Okay, so you're going to go in.
Yeah, I'm going to go in and say we're not talking about Mr. Rogers anymore. No. Okay, the carnivore diet with Amber O. And this is definitely not for kids.
No. Because YouTube's also made a rule that everything has to be for people over 13. That's another change.
Interesting.
For people over 13.
Okay, Julia, can you refresh that and see whether I succeeded?
It works just yes, it's perfect. So I'm going to go ahead and share that right now.
Okay, good, good. So we are live, and our guest is L. Amber O'Hearn, who is a data scientist by profession with a background in math, computer science, linguistics, and psychology. And she has been studying and experimenting with low-carb ketogenic diets since 1997, and more recently, writing and speaking about her findings. Her review on the evolutionary appropriateness and benefit of weaning babies onto a meat-based, high-fat, low-carb diet was included as testimony defending Professor Tim Noakes in his recent trial. Amber has been eating a plant-free diet since 2009. Welcome, Amber O'Hearn.
Thank you so much.
So, Julia, have you had a chance to share that with everybody?
Yes, I did. Go ahead and share it on the Facebook wall. So all of our followers should be able to tune in. I know a lot of people are really excited because I've had people asking me exactly what a carnivore diet is, and some people are confused by that, but I think Amber can give us more information.
Sure. Yes.
So what is the carnivore diet and how is it different from zero carb?
Well, it depends on what you mean by both. But when I first started eating a plant-free diet, the people who I learned it from were calling it zero carb or ZC. And what I'm doing isn't any different from that. But the phrase zero carb I found was confusing so many people that I wanted to find something that I thought at the time would be more clear. So people might mistake zero carb to mean, for example, you can eat anything with fiber in it because that doesn't really have any digestible carb, or you could eat plant oils. And on the other hand, they might say, oh, you can't eat liver, you can't have cheese or eggs because they have some small amount of carbohydrate in it. Whereas that wasn't really what we were getting at all. It's really just a distinction between foods that are animal sourced and foods that are plant sourced. And then on top of that, most people who are doing a zero carb diet, wouldn't eat an animal sourced food if it was particularly high in carbohydrates. So honey or even just plain milk was not eaten really by people on this diet. When I started calling it carnivore, the idea behind it was, you know, you're eating only meat, but that also causes confusion because there aren't almost all animals in the world who are labeled as carnivore are known to sometimes eat some plants. So I've gotten into some really quite silly arguments about whether what I'm doing is a carnivore diet or not, but we just need a name. And that's the one that I've been using.
Do you actually eat honey as part of your diet?
Not normally. I've had a little bit here and there, in a way, partly just because I think it's funny that it fits that carnivore label. But my diet's very low in carbohydrates, so it's not really something I'm interested in doing.
Right, because honey actually it has a higher glycemic index, right, than sugar. Isn't that the case?
I don't know for sure, but that sounds quite plausible.
Right. So that would be an example of something that is definitely animal-based, but very high carb.
Yes.
I just have a brief question. So when it comes to like meat to eat, do you feel like organic versus just non-organic is a big issue? Because I know people, that's a very heated topic.
It is a heated topic, and I wouldn't say that quality is completely unimportant, but I will say that at the time that I started eating this way, I certainly didn't have the financial means to buy organic meat, and it didn't matter for the purposes of the health recovery that I experienced, and the other people that I knew weren't doing that either. And so it may be the case that if you eat more organic, you might get even a little bit more benefit, but I think the vast majority of the benefit comes from getting the nutrients that are in the meat and getting rid of the anti-nutrients that are in the plants. One thing that has happened over the years, as I've become more financially stable and as I've deeply appreciated meat and meat producers more in my life and recognized how important they are, I have spent a lot more time going to local farms to get meat, and that does cost more, but I feel really good about it because I can see the way the animals are being treated, and because it there is, I think, a taste difference that I appreciate.
That makes sense. I was just curious, honestly.
That's a great question.
Did you also want to ask about the water while we're at it?
Oh yeah, okay. Water consumption, because I know there was a study done in 1923, which has kind of been debunked, but it's coming back again on YouTube, where people are like, you have to drink 8 glasses of water per day. And now it's like increased to like a gallon of water a day, which I find is excessive. I cannot drink that much water. How much water do you think people really need to be drinking? I guess is kind of my question.
Goodness. Well, I tend to think that our body's appetites for things like that are a really good guide. So I don't think it makes sense to drink more than you're thirsty for. I know when I was growing up, there I did hear the 8 glasses of water a day thing, but I also heard this commonly repeated idea that if you wait until you're thirsty before you drink, then you're already dehydrated. And the more I thought about this, the more perplexing and bizarre it sounded to me, because you can imagine how important water balance is to an organism. I find it really implausible that after however many millions of years of evolution, you would end up with an organism that's so divorced from its ability to understand when it's thirsty or not that it would be causing detriment. So I just find that kind of implausible. In fact, overdrinking water can also be a problem. It can affect your mineral balance, and of course, ultimately, it can cause death, but I think most people aren't drinking that much. I think the rate of for safety is something, it's either a gallon an hour or 2 liters an hour, so that's really extreme. But still, you've got to think that going too, there's such thing as too much, even if it's not going to kill you.
Yeah,
Right.
definitely. Like, I just wanted, because I'm 5'3", and I could barely, I can't do 8 glasses
No,
a day.
neither do I, and I
Yeah, I just,
have the
it's
same
impossible.
problem. But the same thing is true, right? And you were I was reading a chapter of your book on your website, and you were making that same analogy with regard to how many calories that we should eat, and the idea that people don't know that our sense of satiety, that we're full, is not a good enough measure of how much we should be eating. So is the same logic true there?
I think it is, but I think that there are certain foods that are in our food supply commonly that are disrupting satiety. So one theory about that is something like foods are hyper palatable and make you want to eat more than you normally would. I'm not sure that hyper palatability is the right idea, because the suggestion is that if something tastes good, that's enough to make you eat more than you needed. But I do think that there are certain components that can make you eat more. I myself have even found that I will eat more if something is spiced or salted or certainly sweetened, even with a non-caloric sweetener, than I would if it didn't have those things added to it. And it's not because the food is tasteless. It's just because I think I'm getting some kind of pleasure or something that's distinct from the satiety effect.
So how do you feel about MSG? Does that fall within those parameters?
That's a great question. I haven't looked into MSG for a really long time, but I think maybe you can help me out with this, but monosodium glutamate, doesn't it activate the umami taste receptors?
Yeah, I believe so.
And does that make you want to eat more, or does it just make you...
I'm not sure.
I could imagine it either way, because if it's a flavor enhancer, then maybe it's causing you to desire it more. But on the other hand, if it's signaling that you're getting something that you need, then maybe it would actually cause early satiety. I don't know. Maybe I'll have to do an experiment with that.
Yeah, I don't know. I remember that we used to like it. We used to add it to soups and things like that to make them more savory, and also to rice. And then something came out that it was bad for us, that it causes hair loss and all sorts of other things. But then it turned out that that wasn't true. So I don't know.
Yeah, I know some people actually in the Asian community still use MSG. I have some Asian friends. They still use it. So and they're okay.
Yes. No, I actually noticed that my mother is from Israel, and she has a soup broth cubes. They have MSG in them. She didn't know that because she doesn't look at ingredients, but they certainly make soups and rice taste better.
Well, that's a take-home homework question for me. I'll get back to you.
Okay. All right. So I hear that you do drink coffee, and that is plant-based. What's the explanation about that?
It's my plant vice. The explanation is that when I started this diet, which was intended to be completely temporary as an experiment to my goal was for weight loss. And I was learning about this diet from a forum who were doing this diet. And it was generally agreed upon that coffee didn't seem to take away from the positive effects that people were seeing. And since I was already a coffee drinker, I felt like it was enough to go through this whole dietary change without also going through the effort of withdrawing from coffee. And if I didn't have to, I wasn't going to. And so because I too had all these great health effects without removing coffee, I just kept it when I decided to keep going with the diet. I have subsequently tried quitting a couple of times. The most recent time was not this past summer, but the summer before. I quit for the whole summer from the solar solstice, the summer solstice to the fall equinox, so 3 months. just to make sure that I wasn't missing something, because I'm always telling people, like, just because you think you feel great doesn't mean that making some change won't make you go, oh my gosh, I didn't know I could feel this good. And so I thought, you know, maybe it's time to check that out. And I didn't feel any improvement whatsoever. So I happily started having coffee again in the fall. But yeah, it's a plant. There are other things that I have had from the beginning, not on a daily basis like coffee, but from time to time that I try to be open and transparent about. So things that I've had include occasional wine, although I didn't drink any alcohol the first 5 years. Since then, well, I suppose almost all alcohol is plant-based, but wine sort of seems more culpable in a plant-based sense because there's so much plant residue left over. So if I have a glass of vodka, yeah, it was derived from potato or grain or whatever it was, but is that really a plant now? I don't know. But wine, yeah. So I do have an occasional wine. I have had squares of 100% chocolate. I've even had 90% probably twice.
What was the other 10% when it was 90%?
I suppose it's probably a little bit of milk solids and sugars.
Yeah.
But I honestly found that a bit too sweet. Because, you know, if you don't eat any sugar at all, everything becomes crazy sweet. Butter is sweet.
Butter is sweet. Yes, it is.
The cream, yeah. Makes sense.
And the other thing that I'll have from time to time, sometimes I go for sashimi at a Japanese restaurant. And in that context, I will allow myself the soy sauce and the wasabi. And sometimes I'll even take a little bit of the radish, the daikon that's shredded, just so I can get a little bit more of the wasabi. So obviously that's not really something that comes up very often, but those things I have found I can do that. It's not a case where I have an intolerance that's so acute that my mood crashes or my health goes down if I have one of these things one time. But I have a strong suspicion that if I started doing it every day, it might not be as sustainable for me. It's not really something I've tested, because the reason I'm on a carnivore diet is because I had bipolar disorder. And I suppose there's some sense in which I still do, because it's not considered something you don't have anymore. But I've been in remission since I started the carnivore diet, and I really don't want to mess around with bringing back depressive symptoms.
Right. I'm going to admit that I was on the carnivore diet, and I'm not currently 100% carnivore. I am very low carb. But when I was on it for about 3 months, I did start to have a craving for pickles.
Fascinating. Pickles is another thing that I've had from time to time. And I have a story that you might find interesting. Do you know about the current controversy about how much fat versus how much protein in the carnivore world?
The only thing I know is that if you have too much protein, some people say that it turns into carbs. I don't know.
Well, it can, if you,
into
at
glucose,
a certain level,
I guess.
Yeah, into glucose, that's not exactly what happens, but that is what people say. What happens is, as your protein level increases, there's a certain point where ketogenesis stops. And then the protein substrate, protein's always being used to make glucose, even when you're ketogenic, because you need some. So definitely you don't want to go too high protein, but most of the time that I've been carnivore, my fat level has been somewhere between 65 and 75%, not on purpose, not as a target, but just that's what it's turned out to be when I've looked at it and measured it. I really don't like having to measure my food. That's boring. And it's never had a great effect. But some people are, it's really important to them that they're in a certain therapeutic level of ketosis. And for them, definitely 65 and sometimes even 75 is not going to be enough. And so they are targeting 80%, which is sometimes called 2-to-1, because that's 2 grams of fat per gram of protein. And I one time sort of half jokingly called this keto AF, as in ketogenic animal foods, and the name stuck. So I was playing around experimenting with this, and I was doing fine, doing great. I felt good. And then one day I had this huge craving for sashimi. And it was 2 p.m. and my boyfriend was working, and I thought, if he wants to come with me, I'll wait until he gets off work. But if he doesn't, I'm going right now. So I called him, and of course he said he wanted to go. So I said, all right, I'll wait. And then I suddenly had a craving for pickle juice. And I thought, that's weird.
Exactly.
And so I went to the fridge. I have dill pickles in the house. And I drank maybe, it might have been about half a cup of pickle juice. And I immediately stopped caring about the sashimi.
Wow.
And then I thought, it wasn't a protein craving. I had assumed I just was having a severe protein craving. But I think what I was craving is either the minerals that come along with the protein, or that wasabi and soy with all the salt that I don't normally eat otherwise. So all of this is to say, my hypothesis about why you might have started craving pickles was maybe an electrolyte issue, although it's kind of a guess.
Well, I was wondering, because the other thing it could have been in my mind would be that I needed to replenish my microbiome, but that's not really what you're supposed to need if you're only on meat, right?
Right. Yeah. So I think pickles are probably pretty innocuous, in part because cucumbers are probably the least offensive plant that I can think of in terms of anti-nutrients. They're technically a fruit, so they don't have as many fighting chemicals as a plant would put out into its roots or its leaves, which it really doesn't want to be eaten. And it's not a sweet fruit, so it doesn't have, you know, a glucose problem. And it's mostly water. So I would tend to say that pickles or plain cucumbers, if I were to try to reintroduce a plant into my diet on a daily basis, that would actually be it.
The other possibility is that it's acid, you know, that it really, because it wasn't a cucumber craving, it was a pickle craving.
Right. You're not pregnant.
No.
That is the old stereotype. But yeah, that's a good point too. It could be something to do with hydrochloric acid in your stomach, or that's a good hypothesis.
I mean, when we talk about dogs, because I will be talking about other animals and all, one of the things that they say that the reason that they can be on the, you know, on a carnivorous diet is because they have extremely good acid that can take care of any animal product. Do we have less acid, or do you know anything about that?
Yeah, we actually have more.
You do?
If you're talking about the stomach pH, it's really surprising, actually. We have scavenger-level acid in our stomachs. If you compare across species, it's one of the lowest pHs, or which, in other words, highest acidity of any animals. We're like near vulture level. And it's interesting because the hypothesis about why scavengers have such high acidity is because what they're eating has had a chance to accumulate more bacteria, and so it's supposed to have this effect of fighting off bacteria. And so now our acidity can get compromised by nutrient deficiencies, and also I think if you're eating a lot of carbohydrates, I'm not 100% sure about this, but I've read that that can over time reduce the acidity of your stomach. And I know that some people who have digestive issues, where a lot of people believe that's from high stomach acid, it's actually from insufficiently high stomach acid.
Yes.
So I do have another question, because I read an interview where you said sometimes traveling can be difficult because you can't really eat the local cuisine. When you traveled, like, how do you find food that's meeting the zero carb diet? Like, do you bring it with you, or do you just go to the store? Like, what's your action plan, I guess?
A mix of both. It depends where I'm going. I'm fortunate that, like I said, I don't have acute food sensitivities. So I know people who are on a carnivore diet who absolutely can't even go to a restaurant, because if it's contaminated with anything, they'll have a reaction. I'm not like that. So I can get a burger that's served in a bun and take the bun off and I'll still be fine. But it's maybe not the most fun food. If I'm going somewhere for a while, I'll definitely do shopping, especially if I have access to a kitchen. And if it's a short trip, sometimes I will bring my own food. So I'll bring either cooked meat. One of my favorite travel things to bring, it's a little bit of a time sink to make it, but I sometimes make my own pemmican, which is the Native American travel food that is, it's basically you make jerky out of very lean meat and you pulverize it into a powder, and you take tallow, animal fat, and melt it. And then you take them both at equal weight proportions and mix it together. And then it hardens. Depending on the exact composition of the fat, it'll harden more or less. And it comes out to a beautiful ratio of about 2-to-1 or 80%. And it just travels really, really well because the fat coats it, and the dryness of the meat gets out organisms that can grow in something that's wet, and the fat further encases that. And so that's a really excellent travel food. Not everybody loves it, but, and I don't have any financial conflict of interest here, but I know that someone is making a product now. Their Kickstarter has ended and they're not in sales yet, but it's called the Carnivore Bar, and it's basically pemmican, which they have taken great pains not to add anything to it except for meat and fat, and then they've gotten the best fat that they can find to make the hardest consistency so it'll travel well. And I tasted their product when they were in development, and it's fantastic. I can't wait until it comes out.
Are they going to have problems with the FDA in terms of not adding preservatives?
Well, apparently they've gone through whatever hoops they needed to go through.
Okay, that's great. That's great. Yeah, so I was really struck by your description of what went on with chimpanzee digestion, the fact that they have a cecum, the fact that their hindgut is more than ours, and that, in fact, when we think of them as eating plant matter, they're not really utilizing the plant matter in the way that we do for glucose metabolism. Am I understanding what you said correctly?
Yeah, absolutely. So herbivores and hindgut fermenters in particular, what they do is they mostly eat fiber, but fiber, no, No mammal, no vertebrate actually has the ability by itself to digest fiber, but microbes in the gut can digest fiber. And when they do, the result of their digestion is fat in the form of short chain fatty acids. So what herbivores do is they have really large colons and cecums, which house an enormous number of microbes that are like a factory for turning fiber into fat. And so that's how they get the majority of their calories. You know, because our digestive system changed over the course of a couple million years, we don't have the capacity to break down as much fiber because we don't have as much room for bacteria. It's been estimated by some people that we could get 200 calories a day, but I looked at the paper that's based on, and I think that they're making assumptions. I would suggest that it's more like 70 calories a day. But even if we could get 200 calories a day out of eating 100 grams of fiber a day, which would probably not be very comfortable.
No, I think that would be very painful.
Yeah, it could be, and it could actually cause blockages and other problems. I wouldn't recommend trying it. But even if we could, that's still only going to go so far toward our caloric requirements. And so because this change in digestive system happened even long before we had the ability to really make, we didn't have, you know, grain agriculture, and we didn't have a widespread use of fire. And even if we did, so the reason why fire is important is because you would need it if you were going to break down the starch in tubers in order to be able to use it. We wouldn't necessarily have had access to that consistently enough to get all of our caloric needs met by carbohydrates either. And since it's known that we were eating a lot of animal fat, in fact, as far back as Australopithecus in more than 2 million years ago has been shown to have broken into bones to get marrow and brains for nutrition. That's when our brains started expanding. And so that we have this like sort of co-evolution of the influx of animal fat, which is a direct source of fat, and our brain expansion happening, and then a shrinking of the ability to rely on fiber for fat. And I think that those are all intimately related. So in terms of numbers, I think at least in terms of relative proportions, Catherine Milton has a paper that I don't agree with everything that's in that paper, but she has a really nice graph of the relative proportions of different parts of the digestive tract in different primates. And you can see that in chimpanzees and gorillas, for example, the colon is about 50% or a little more than 50% of their digestive tract, whereas in humans, and that's volume, I think, and in humans, it's like 15%. So it's really quite substantial difference.
So what happens is, of course, that when we give fruit to chimpanzees, even though they might want to digest it the way they would fiber, they're going on a glucose metabolism. What would you recommend would be better to feed them? Because sometimes what they try to, you know, when that doesn't work, when they feel that the chimp is overweight, they will put them on some kind of a so-called monkey chow, which is, you know, primarily like all the chows based on cornmeal.
Oh, goodness.
So I think there's a problem.
Yeah, so I'm sure that chimps can handle some fruit, and they definitely have fruit in their wild diet, but my understanding is that what's meant by fruit is something that's a lot more fibrous. And so there's a lot of
pith. My understanding too. Yes.
And also that they have a lot of folivory or leaf eating.
Yes.
So my guess would be that there must be a range of leaves and higher fiber fruits that we wouldn't consider particularly edible just from a gustatory point of view for humans, right? Might be something that they would like. I know that there were headlines a few years ago about chimpanzees in zoos getting diabetes from being overfed fruit, and I thought that was really alarming.
There are things about the fruit that is available to us, you know, when we think about apples and bananas and pears and all of those things, they're just so full of sugar. And I don't think that any of our ancestors, when they ate fruit, were eating that kind of fruit.
Or at least not mostly, like maybe occasionally. And I can see why an animal would like it.
Yes, of course.
It's highly calorically dense, and we can tell right away.
Right. So after listening to some of your lectures and thinking about what I know about chimpanzees and about humans, I was beginning to wonder, is there any animal that was meant to get most of its energy from glucose metabolism? And if there is such an animal, what is it? And is it, I mean, how does the animal world divide in terms of ketosis versus glycolysis?
That's a really interesting question. I think there may be animals in certain regions or seasonally who rely heavily on fruit. So for example, I think that a lot of birds eat a lot of berries and other fruits, especially in the fall, and especially migrating birds use fruit to fatten before they fly long distances. They're really interesting because they have a very cyclical metabolism where they will eat fruit and fatten up, and then they will migrate and not eat at all and use ketosis while they're fasted to fly. And I think that's really interesting. There are fruit bats, but I don't really know what the specifics, like what that means. Does fruit to a fruit bat mean more like fruit to a chimpanzee or more like fruit to a bird? I don't know. And then of course, there are, like, hibernating bears are known to eat berries and such, but only also when they're in that period where they're preparing not to eat.
Okay. And I assume that hummingbirds live primarily on sugar.
Yeah, I think that's a great example. I think that's probably exactly right.
I know it's bad actually to feed them like the sugar things that people make for them. And I've heard that's not good for them and that you should let them find flowers. I just read that. Do you think that's true?
Oh, what was the specific idea about it being bad for them? Was it bad because it's a dependence on humans?
And it also was just too much like dense in sugar. Like I had heard that people were concerned for hummingbirds becoming too dependent on that and also putting on weight. Like it's not natural for them, and then they don't go around and find flowers.
I don't know, but it sounds plausible to me, because again, if we're using it as an attractant for our own visual pleasure, then of course we're giving them a source that we expect is going to compete with what they would naturally have, and to compete it should be sweeter or more fragrant or something. Another
also,
idea.
They might not pollinate. I mean, if they're supposed to be helping with pollination.
Right.
Yeah.
And that brings to mind the other thing I was going to say is that some insects definitely seem to thrive on glucose. And sometimes it's seasonal and sometimes I'm not sure. It might just be all year round. But bees definitely also thrive on nectar and honey.
Right. That's why honey always seemed to me to be something that, even though it is animal based, somehow doesn't belong in the carnivore diet.
Right. Wasps My observation, and I've never looked this up to see if this is correct, but it seems to me that wasps are seeking sweetness in the spring and meat in the fall. Like they'll go after your juice cans in the spring, and then they'll be like trying to get your barbecue in the fall. But I might be wrong about that, but that's just something that seems to correlate to me. But they're definitely more omnivorous.
Okay, so let's now just sort of focus on mammals. Among the mammals, how many are supposed to be getting most of their energy, or in the past did get most of their energy from a sugar, from glucose?
I think all of them. I think besides humans, we don't know of any animal that is in ketosis except when they are underfed. So, well, a bird's not a mammal, but I gave that bird example of when they're flying, they're in ketosis. And we know that lots of mammals and other animals have ketosis of fasting. But obviously I've not looked at all animals, but of all the animals that I was able to find any data on, the only ones that can get into ketosis without either caloric restriction or protein restriction or adding MCT oils or some, or over-exercising or some combination of that, are humans and maybe barely rodents. Well, okay, yes, rodents. But the thing with rodents is the line between too little protein to be adequate to support them and too much for ketosis is like vanishingly small. So it's really hard to get mice or rats into ketosis without giving them too little protein. You can just barely do it. But humans, on the other hand, there's like a whole range. Of course, it's going to vary individually because of a variety of factors. But basically, if you look across studies, no one's ever, as far as I know, tried to determine this specifically empirically. But if you look across studies, you can see that you can get people into ketosis completely fed, like they can be weight stable and be in ketosis, but they can also have more protein than has been determined to meet the requirements. So they're in nitrogen balance. They're taking in more protein than they're disposing of, and yet there's no sign of lack of ketosis until protein gets very, very high, like maybe twice as much as the minimum. So I think that's really extraordinary, actually.
But are you saying that it's known that chimps do not do that? I mean, is it?
No. I don't think anyone's ever tested chimps on a low-carb diet, which is kind of astounding. Like, we know that, for example, I've seen a paper, I'm trying to think of the name, maybe it'll come to me while I'm talking, but it's on orangutans, and okay, is shown that orangutans seasonally have some level of ketosis because they have a season where they overeat and a season where they undereat, but mm-hmm. that's undereating again. So That's the closest that I've ever seen. And it's a great unknown question. I would love to find out about it.
Okay. Yeah, I would too, because I don't know, I don't know much about orangutans, but they don't seem to be as muscular as chimpanzees. The thing about chimpanzees is they almost have no fat on their body.
Right.
Normally. And
And I think that's a huge clue, because even the leanest human, like if you try to imagine who's the leanest human, you think of a bodybuilder, right? They mm-hmm. have gotten their body fat as low as they can possibly get it. And they're still like four times fatter than a regular chimp.
But if you look at hunter-gatherer societies, I think that you might see that they're quite a bit leaner than your muscle man in our society, I think.
I think that's not correct. I have some studies about this, but like I think chimpanzee level body fat in males is like under 1%. It's insane. It's
you know,
just like
yeah,
you said.
That's definitely true. That's they can support their own weight. You know, they can just lift themselves up.
That's
yeah.
Really cool. But I think that this ties into ketosis because now this is, I'm going off on a bit of speculation, but it is kind of a pet theory of mine that one of the reasons for this mysterious level of body fat that is like in babies, of course, it's even more pronounced. Baby humans are fatter than baby seals.
Oh, that's interesting.
And the reason that some people have speculated about that is because they need to fuel the brain. And of course, they're doing that by ketosis. And so by extrapolation, I'm thinking, well, maybe humans have this relationship with fat that's so long established and so important that they actually carry more on their body in order to enable ketosis to happen at a good rate. Because we know that If you take a human that gets too lean and you just feed them protein, they will get sick. They need to be intaking fat.
Yes.
Whereas if they've got more on their body, they can handle that for a while.
So
that's the theory.
I have another question. Like when it comes to raw meat versus cooked meat, do you think there's a difference? Because there are some people I've heard, they think all meat they eat should be raw. Like they're eating very similar to you, but they only eat raw meat. Do you have a take on that?
Not a very strong one. I'm definitely familiar with this idea. I think that raw meat can be very satiating in a way that cooked meat doesn't seem to be quite as. I enjoy raw meat, and there are certainly some nutrients that are susceptible to cooking, and there are, I think, some of the arguments that they talk about have to do with enzymes or with proteins getting misfolded or something during the cooking. And I have an open mind about it, but I'm somewhat skeptical. I do think that overcooking and only eating completely cooked meat can rob you of certain nutrients, in particular vitamin C. If you're relying on an only meat diet and you want to get enough vitamin C, you can't have completely well done meat as your only source or it won't be enough. I do know that a lot of people swear by the raw meat diet. I have tried it for up to days at a time, so maybe that's not a fair trial. Of course, it's a trade-off in safety because cooking does destroy pathogens, and that can be important. It's
so interesting. While we're talking about cooking, I want to talk about dogs. And so, again, I have experience with dogs in Israel that used to be fed butcher scraps, such as chicken heads and chicken feet. And in those days, you would go and get that. That was very good for your dog, and it was very cheap. And you would give it to your dog, and your dog would go and bury it. And then he would unbury some other chicken heads and other chicken legs that you gave him last week or however long ago, and eat those because he liked them a little bit savory, shall we say.
That is fascinating.
Yeah, what is the reason for that? Are they trying to cook their own food?
Well, before I speculate on that, I want to know more about that. Is that something that was done as a supplement, or was that kind of the main thing that they were being fed?
That was, well, you know, I have limited experience. So I had experience with a German Shepherd, and that was his main diet. That was the main diet.
That's
there
really
was
neat.
No dog food. There was no dog food
Yeah,
there.
I think commercial pet food is really a recent invention and maybe not for everyone's benefit.
Well, Julia and I were reading the ingredients yes. on dog food and cat food,
yes.
and they have all sorts of grains in them. They have cornmeal. They have what else do they have?
Tapioca fillers, like all sorts of emulsifiers.
But yeah, it very low fat content. I mean, even those things that are taken from animal product are more like meal. So there's like ground meal for calcium, but the fat in the kibble, which is the dry dog food, it's a very low fat content. And I think that dogs need a much higher fat content. If you take the, and they say weird things like they put moisture in and they don't say what the moisture consists of. And I
that
mean,
is a strange thing. I mean, you'd think if it were water, they'd just say water.
Right, right. So I have no idea what this moisture is on dry dog food, which doesn't seem very moist. And the other, in their other dog food, which is supposed to be the wet dog food, they do actually say that they used water to cause it to be wet, but it's really not supposed to be just the wetness. It should be fat, you know.
Right.
So
it's a cornmeal base. That's why they're doing it, because they're cheap and cornmeal's cheaper and they can stretch it out. I think
exactly.
That's the reason.
And they put wheat gluten in it too.
For protein, I guess.
Yeah.
So as to the burying thing, I don't know, but I wonder if a period of rest like that allows some of the proteins to start breaking down mm-hmm. in a way that makes it more digestible. Some people
speculate, yeah.
You know, some people go beyond the raw meat diet thing for humans that Julia was talking about and actually do a lot of fermented meat, which sounds crazy, but if you think about it, fermented dairy is very culturally common in the West, and if you look at more northern climes, fermented meat is actually quite common too, although we're quite enculturated against it. But I've seen people on these raw forums who also ferment their own liver or eat other forms of, they call it high meat because that's the old description.
So okay, when they start to do this, I speculate that it has something to do with the microbiome. I mean, doesn't it seem reasonable that if they are fermenting it, it's because they believe it will help their digestion because they need some kind of microbes to help them digest it?
Yeah, you might think of it this way. Because we gave up so much microbial ability to pre-digest things, we instead started outsourcing. So when we take even, you know, a lot of cultures that are using grains have a lot of anti-nutrients and then they're not very easy to digest and they've got a lot of things that are not that good for you, but that can be mitigated quite a lot by processes like fermentation and in some cases cooking. Or so if you ferment your grains or if you ferment your meat even, or if you ferment your cabbage, all of that gives the food I'm not sure how to phrase this, but what I was going to say was gives food opportunity to have some of those processes done that we don't any longer have the ability to do. So it could make, certainly for plant foods, it could make things that we just simply wouldn't handle well into something that we can. I don't know why you would want to do it for meat. It could be partly a storage tactic, especially before refrigeration. If the choices are drying it and fermenting it, fermenting does have some advantages, including nutrient preservation, the over drying, which can compromise some of that. And if you're fermenting it underground or underwater, which was a common way to do it, then you're also getting protection from predators.
Right.
Makes sense.
But, you know, birds, getting back to birds, when they're feeding their young, they regurgitate their food. So apparently they pre-digest it for the baby, right?
Oh, yeah, that's right.
And they also do that during courtship for their mate, just as if she can do it.
How sweet of you.
Right. So what do you think about the business with parrots? You know, when we keep birds in the house and they don't fly around a lot. I mean, even if we allow them to fly all over the house, they're obviously not working as hard as they would if they were migrating or looking for their food. Mm-hmm. So, they don't get the opportunity to eat too many insects when they are under our care, and we give them seeds. And the seeds are high in fat. But there's a movement in among the bird owners to try to get their birds to go off the seeds and onto pellets. And again, the pellets are a kind of kibble for birds, which includes, I mean, it's meant to be lower fat. And the argument that they make about it is it's better for the bird because we don't want the bird to be overweight, but they're thinking that the fat in the seeds is too much nutrition for them, considering the fact that they don't exercise enough.
That sounds kind of backwards to me. I have no expertise in birds, but the way that I understand food that's high in nutrition, and particularly food that's high in fat, is that, again, like with the water thirst thing, you've got your brain, your appetite signals are all built to detect when you've had enough. And so if you're getting a food that would have been a normal food in your environment, then for the most part, you should expect satiety to kick in and to tell you when you got enough. I wouldn't expect fat to be something that birds would overeat necessarily and become fat. Do they have any evidence for that, or is it really just theoretical?
I
don't think they have any evidence whatsoever. But I mean, this is the argument they're making. And it seems to me, I mean, I'm not saying that feeding them seeds is the most natural thing in the world, because I suspect they would be eating insects as well.
Right.
I see the birds eat worms outside, like in the middle of the day when they have a chance.
So if I were moving away from seeds, I would be moving toward meat-based a little bit more, but they're going the other way. They're going toward grain and they're trying to make it more of a high carb diet, it seems to me, and that's really bizarre.
Yeah, it seems like there might be extrapolating from ideas that aren't even working in humans.
exactly. But I mean, if you're aware of any research, if you can later share with us any articles about animal nutrition and how it relates to what we're finding out about human nutrition, I think that would be helpful.
So what birds in particular do you have?
Well, I have two cockatiels and a Quaker parrot, but I mean, these are all people who have parrots of some sort. They're usually, we're not talking about raising chickens, or we're not talking about pigeons usually, but just, you know, one of the reasons that we end up with birds from the Amazon as our pets, and also birds from Australia, and is because if we went out into the yard and picked up a bird and tried to tame it, that would be against the law, because the local species are protected. So this is why we, you know, when we do have pets, they come from far away.
That's interesting.
Right.
Yeah, I don't, I don't have a good understanding of how much carbohydrate would be in the natural diet of a parrot, but it seems to me, just guessing, that insofar as there were, it would be from fruit, not from grains, right?
Right. And some of the people also suggest that you give them chop, that you chop up fruit for them, that you chop up vegetables for them. But it seems to me that if you do that, and if they're eating that, they will get fatter on this. So the concern that they would get too fat on the seeds is unfounded.
Yeah, I mean, it's energy either way.
Right. Well, yeah. True. But yeah, no, my particular Quaker parrot insists that I feed him oatmeal, because when I prepare oatmeal for the chimp, he wants it too. And of course, there's milk and sugar and oatmeal in there. And I don't know whether that's good for him, but that's what he wants.
Sounds like you have a very interesting home life.
Yes. Well, we do also have two dogs. And one of them is 8 years old, and he just can't handle the kibble at all anymore. I think there is a problem with the digestion of older dogs that has everything to do with what is in the dog food.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a shame that our animal care has been so corrupted. I think in the livestock industry, it's actually a lot saner, somewhat ironically, in part because the health of the animal is the bottom line of the business, whereas the business in the pet industry is, well, it's actually the bottom line of the food company, not of the actual health of the pets. So they can say whatever they want, and your results don't have any actual feedback loop to their product. Whereas if you're talking about pigs or cattle, if the feed that's being sold to you actually results in worse health, you stop buying, because you fire them, because it matters to you for your bottom line.
Right.
They can't get away with that there.
Julia, do we have any questions from our audience?
We haven't had any questions per se, but there is somebody named Logical Links, and he seems to be a big fan of you, Amber, because he did say hello. So,
hi, Josh.
Excited that you're on.
Thanks for watching.
Okay, well, I do have some questions that were given to me. These are not my questions, but when people I know heard that you were going to be on the show, they had some questions for you. And so somebody knows someone who has kidney stones and suggested the carnivore diet to this person, but they were told that red meat causes kidney stones or kidney failure, so they shouldn't have red meat. What do you think about that?
There's no evidence for that. However, I'm not sure that a carnivore diet is going to completely alleviate stones. The best thing that I know for stones is, first of all, lots of fluid, because you want to be able to dissolve them. But in addition to that, citrate compounds. So potassium citrate is actually used clinically to help dissolve stones, or you can get it through, for example, lime juice. So drinking a lot and making sure you're getting a lot of citrates can help get rid of that in an acute sense.
But there's no indication that red meat causes kidney stones.
No.
Okay. Okay, another question about health is, what if you don't have a gallbladder? What if you've had your gallbladder removed? Does that mean you should eat less fat and therefore less meat?
It may be a little difficult initially, but I know lots of people, some personally and others that I've just chatted with or seen their comments, who have had their gallbladder removed, and they're quite able to do a high-fat ketogenic diet of any stripe without any difficulty. And one of the reasons for that is that the gallbladder is kind of a backup reservoir of bile. It's not the producer of bile, so it's not kind of fatal to the system for bile production. It only means that that's not a place where you'll be storing it. And I've even heard that a new kind of, I forget what they call it, but new pockets will form to serve that same function over time. One thing that's interesting about gallbladder problems and gallstones is that they can sometimes be triggered by a high fat diet if you've been on a very low fat diet for a long time, because your gallbladder has gone into disuse and may have become blocked, but it didn't become a problem until you asked for it to act again. And so apparently it's quite common for that to happen when you transition from low fat to high fat. And so if you're on a very low fat diet and you're thinking of going to a high fat diet, that might be a consideration for doing that gradually.
Okay, that makes sense. Okay, and there was a question about coffee, but I think we actually covered that one.
It's a drug.
I love it. I don't, coffee's my favorite.
Okay, so, okay, this one is a little bit difficult. I think I know what it means. The question is, do you think it stresses our bodies or our brain to have to process different types of foods at once as opposed to one type? So for instance, if you only eat vegetables one meal, or you only eat meat, or you just eat meat, does that reduce stress on the digestive system as a whole? And could it be that the carnivore diet is helpful for that reason and not necessarily because for some other reason? Did that make any sense?
I think so. I think it sounds like they're alluding to the kind of food combining ideas that have been popular from time to time. I do think that there can be competition for digestion, I suppose. Like you can dilute your digestive enzymes and then they wouldn't be very effective. But no, I don't think that's the primary reason that a carnivore diet is so helpful. I think that the digestive capacity should be able to handle a variety of different things all at once.
Okay, so we don't have to separate our foods per se.
I don't think so.
That's a popular theory on both ends of the spectrum. Like the other extreme says that you should only eat watermelon or something. I think it's a theory, right?
So what about intermittent fasting? Do you do that? What do you think about it?
I've played around with it from time to time. I have some opinions on fasting. I think intermittent fasting is more important if you're not on a ketogenic diet, because I think fasting has the two highest benefits of fasting, let's put it that way, are the ketogenic state that it puts you in, which you're already going to be on a carnivore diet if you're eating enough fat. And second, the removal of foods that cause an inflammatory response. And carnivore goes a long way to doing that. So a lot of people I've heard say, the only time I really feel well is when I'm fasting. Haven't tried being ketogenic and removing all of these plant kind of, what would I call them, irritants. And just doing that alone, I think, can give you almost all the benefits of intermittent fasting. On the other hand, if you're eating constantly, even on a carnivore diet, you're not going to get into as deep a level of ketosis, and you're not going to get into the other phase of your metabolism that's very important. One thing I would say is that when you're on a carnivore diet, as long as you're not eating constantly, and I'll add another caveat that when you first start one, I think you should just eat whenever you feel hungry and it will settle out. But what does tend to happen over time is that people tend to, the most frequent that I see is that people go settle into a 2-meal-a-day regime, which is basically the sort of beginner level intermittent fasting already. And one thing that's really interesting about fasting, I just gave a talk on this in October, actually. When you fast, the part of the reason for it is supposed to be to inhibit mTOR, which is a kind of integration sensor of nutrition. And when it's low, your body does all kinds of amazing repair things, or things preparing for repair, actually. It's not the repair, the buildup itself, but it's the clearing away. And autophagy is a buzzword that goes along with that. But it just means taking down pieces of your body that were not functioning that well and salvaging them so that they can be recycled. The interesting thing about this is that mTOR is lowered whenever you're in a ketogenic state. Even if you have protein, as soon as that starts to recede, if you're on a ketogenic diet, you're gonna get into that state much quicker than if you're on a high carb diet. So some people advocate for periodic, like 5-day fasts. And if you're on a high carb diet, you've got to understand that 3 of those days are to get you to ketosis in the first place.
Oh.
So if you're on a carnivore diet and you're in mild ketosis, you could get the same effect probably in 2 days of fasting that you could get that would take you 5 days if you're on a high carbohydrate diet. So I think that intermittent fasting can be beneficial, especially if you have certain kinds of problems, disease states, chronic issues, but you might not need as much fasting as you think if you're looking at research that is targeted toward high carb diets and you're already in a ketogenic state.
Okay. That's fascinating.
I hope that made sense.
Yeah, that's very interesting. I feel like I'm learning a lot of new things from the research you're sharing.
Cool.
Well, I wonder what happens if you have to be hospitalized for any reason. Let's say you're in an accident, you were in ketosis the whole time, but you go into the hospital and they're assuming that you're eating like everybody else. Is that going to be a problem?
Well, I particularly worry about the case of traumatic brain injury, because if they put you on an IV that includes glucose, that's the worst thing that you could possibly do for a couple of reasons. One is that a ketogenic state actually has been shown in experiments, at least it wouldn't be ethical in humans, but at least in some animal experiments, to be neuroprotective in the case of brain trauma. So the last thing you want to do is get out of ketosis as soon as you have brain trauma. But more than that, if you're in a ketogenic state, you're going to be super insulin resistant. And so your response to that glucose is going to be way higher than if you weren't already ketogenic. There was a point in time where I was considering getting one of those medic alert bracelets saying, no glucose drip in ketosis, keep me in ketosis. But someone has actually told me recently that they no longer use glucose drips routinely. They usually use saline.
Saline, okay.
However, I don't know for sure if that's the case. And I think it might be prudent to have some way of communicating that you want to be kept in a ketogenic state. Surely epileptics they probably wear medic alerts. I don't know, it might be a bit extreme, but I have considered it in the past.
Right. Yeah, because I think the medical community still doesn't really understand about any of this.
I think you're right.
So Charlotte just said the answer to fasting makes sense, and she thanks you for giving that insight.
Oh, you're welcome. I'm glad it made sense.
Yeah, and she had some other questions, I believe. So she asked, do you ever listen to other carnivores such as Sean Baker or Michaela Peterson?
Well, it depends on what you mean by listen. I don't spend a lot of time on podcasts just because there are so many and it's really hard to tell what they're going to contain because there's so much spontaneity in them. But I definitely have listened to Sean and Michaela plenty. Both of them spoke at the carnivore conference that I put on in March of this year. We're doing another conference in May. In case you're interested, come and see.
Where is it going to be?
I heard it's going to be live, right? You're going to do it online too?
Yeah, I'm doing a live stream this time. It's in Boulder, Colorado. It's going to be in the same places this year at the Boulder Theater, and tickets are on sale. It's May 23rd and 24th. I'm really excited.
Yeah, it's very exciting. So is there any chance that you will add some animal component to your lectures there?
You mean about other species?
Yes, a comparison, information about what diets are good for them and how their digestive processes compare to ours, and how their source of energy compares to ours.
You know, I haven't prepared to do any more talks in that direction. It's going to come up a bit in my book as that unfolds, but for you, I might not add anything you haven't already seen.
Okay. Well, I want to encourage you to look into that because I don't think anybody else is, and I would certainly spread the word, and if I were writing any articles about it, I would cite you.
Thank you. It's really wonderful to have someone who appreciates that aspect because it's been something that I've really enjoyed looking into and also been really surprised that there isn't more work on it.
Julia, do you have any other additional questions?
I guess I would like to ask one more thing because I read a little bit, just your bio, and I heard that you were vegetarian, but then you started eating more meat when you studied in Russia. Is that correct? Or did I get that wrong? Did you study abroad for a bit?
I did, yeah. And I had been vegetarian and even had gone vegan before I left for Russia. And I could have, had I thought it was extremely important, managed to continue to do that. But it seemed like it wasn't worth the effort. And also I was staying with a family and I wanted to eat what they were eating and have more of the full experience. And so that was when I returned to meat, and that not having a negative impact on my health was part of what helped me reconsider my ideas about vegetarianism.
So would you say Russians, the Russian diet was a little bit more meat dense than a standard American diet? I'm just curious as a comparison, since you spent time in that culture.
I wouldn't necessarily say there's more meat than a Western diet. At the time that I was there, I think vegetarianism was very rare. It might be more popular now. I don't know. That was in the late 90s.
Okay.
So when you were a vegan, was it in order to help yourself or save the planet? I mean, was there an ideological component to it? And if there was, how did that change?
No, it was completely with the goal of health. I was struggling with weight issues that weren't resolving, and I thought maybe that was the reason why.
What do you say to people who are trying to save the planet and they're concerned about, I guess, the carbon footprint and cows and flatulence and all of that? What do you say to them?
Well, first, I think the contribution from livestock, I think, has been greatly overblown. In fact, in some cases, there was actual data that was found later to be wrong, and the authors themselves even retracted it, but no one's citing the new data. But also, it really depends on how the farm is managed. So you can have a farm that's creating more carbon emissions than it's taking in, and you can have the opposite. And so it's really not necessarily a fact about livestock farming. It's just it depends on a lot of different factors. So I really don't think that animals are bad for the planet. I mean, when you think about it, you know, there have been herbivores and ruminants in particular roaming the planet for longer than humans, and that didn't cause the end of the world then, and it's not going to be the major factor now. I think if you think that carbon emissions are a big problem, then what you really need to look at are fossil fuels. That is where you can make a dent. I mean, suppose that you were the manager of a large company and you had a problem that you needed solved, and someone came to you, so you asked one of your employees to analyze the different things that were contributing to this problem, and they gave you this graph of something that's contributing like 85% down to something that's contributing 5%. And you looked at that and said, okay, so what should we do? And the person said, we should definitely attack the 5%. You'd go, are you kidding me? Like, what's the maximum benefit you can get from that versus attacking a problem that's having actually a huge effect? I just think it's not to say that the 5% doesn't matter, but it's just, it's not the biggest impact you can have. Yeah, and when you take into account the impact on human health, suddenly it doesn't make any sense whatsoever.
Right. And also the way that we're raising grains, I think that has a much bigger impact than the way we raise cattle.
Oh, definitely. I mean, rice paddies contribute almost as much methane carbon dioxide emissions as cattle do, but nobody is saying don't eat rice. I think it's really politically motivated, I guess, is what I'm trying to say. I don't think the facts are being really objectively looked at.
Yeah, it can't be. I mean, you have to look at like certain plant products are causing a lot of devastation. Like, you know, palm oil is hurting orangutan habitats in Indonesia. Like, so it's not always the most humane.
Not only that, but if you're getting it from there, then you're also flying it over, presumably.
Yeah.
I guess you could be using a boat.
Yeah.
I also have a theory about rice, because I did some research and also had some experiences. But I think that in Asia, rice comes with weevils. In other words, they don't lace it with insecticide quite as much. And so when you're eating rice, you might actually be eating a little bit of meat with it and not know that you're doing that. Whereas in the United States, rice has, you know, it seems to have a lot of arsenic with it. And I don't know if that's just where it's grown or that's part of the insecticide.
Well, chronic arsenic poisoning is a huge problem in Bangladesh. I don't know if it's from rice, but if you start looking into how to deal with arsenic toxicity, all of the papers are motivated by the poor people in Bangladesh. It's terrible.
Wow. Yeah. So how do you stand on vaccination? Because you're dealing with the flu right now. Were you vaccinated for it?
I wasn't vaccinated for the flu. I have all my other vaccinations, and I think vaccinations need to be, you know, considered on a case-by-case basis, because every particular disease has risks associated with it, and every vaccine has risks associated with it. And I think they're almost all, it's better to have the vaccine than to have the risk of getting that disease times what that disease could give you. But the flu in particular, the data that I've seen seems to suggest that it changes so quickly that it's kind of hit or miss whether it's even going to give you any benefit. And because I haven't had a viral illness in 10 years, I never suspected that I should be trying to boost my own immune system in that regard. But actually, I gave up flu vaccines before I went carnivore.
Uh-huh.
So my views are mixed and very specific.
Right. Yeah. Well, I think every person has a different set of experiences with vaccines, because they're getting to be more and more of them as we go by. So for instance, I was vaccinated against rubella, but I had the measles and the mumps.
Mm.
My daughter was vaccinated, you know, had the MMR and all of those things, and also was vaccinated against the chickenpox. And as she was going off That's to right. college, they made her in her last year of high school get a meningitis vaccine. So
really?
Yeah.
I never had any of those as a kid.
My children, there was chickenpox vaccination when my children, when some of my children, I'm trying to figure out who it was. One of my children got chickenpox and the other ones were vaccinated. I actually think, you know, chickenpox is really uncomfortable and I wouldn't wish it on anyone, but I think it might be actually better vaccination than the vaccination, and it's not a high risk disease. And another thing that I've heard, and I don't know the data on it, so it could be wrong, but I've heard that the incidence of shingles is going up because Yes. people aren't naturally being revaccinated by exposure to chickenpox in people around them.
Right.
I heard that too. Like this one lady that didn't have chickenpox said she was afraid to be around us because she thought she might get the shingles. Like, I don't know if that's true or...
What I heard was that grandparents used to be they would be around the kids when they got the chicken pox. And that's about the time where if they were exposed to their grandchildren having the chicken pox, then they wouldn't get the shingles. But if they are not exposed to it because the kids are not getting the disease because they're vaccinated, then the grandparents get the shingles.
Right. Now, of course, you could vaccinate against the shingles, but I don't
right.
know.
Yeah, but then I've heard some people say they came down with it after they were vaccinated, so.
Right. Yeah. I'm definitely in favor of vaccination if the disease is, you know, like polio, something that's absolutely devastating or that could cause meningitis or, you know, it's just stuff you don't want to mess around with. If it's something that's just uncomfortable and might have some benefits compared to the vaccine, then I feel like it's an individual choice and I don't really have a strong opinion about it. Like, yeah, I've got the flu, but I'll be all right tomorrow.
Yeah, I had never got the flu shot before, by the way, because somebody talked me into it, and I've had a bad reaction for it. From it from the last week. So I was just kind of curious about that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I'm staying away from both the vaccine for the flu and hopefully people with the flu.
So. Yeah.
Yeah. So we really appreciate your coming on, especially since you were feeling under the weather, but you got your voice back. And
I did.
Yeah. And so I will continue to see what you're doing, and hopefully you'll be able to share with me some more information that will be helpful for chimpanzees and dogs and parrots.
Yeah, thank you so much for the stimulating conversation. It was really a pleasure, and it's not the kind of thing that most people want to chat about, and so it's really fun to get to geek out about these topics with you.
Well, thank you, Amber, so much for coming on.
Thanks. I feel like I learned a lot of new information, so thank you very much.
You're so welcome.
Good night.
Good night.